Hi. This week we're going to be talking about the films A Single Man and Carol, and thinking about the ways those films deal with fashion, and in particular, fashion in the lives of the gay and lesbian characters they portray. And so I want to use my time talking to you today to give you some background, both on the general historical periods of these two films, and in particular on a few moments in the history of queer fashion. And this is not a complete history by any sense. This is just going to be like a little snapshot, a few moments to give you some ideas and some images to contextualize what you see in whichever movie you select to watch for this week. So I've already given you a little bit of background in last week's bonus lecture about fashion for women in the 1950s. And if you choose to watch Carol in particular, I think that's going to be really helpful for you to take a look at. So you might want to go back if you didn't get a chance last week and watch that lecture. I'm going to focus somewhat more on men today, but we're also going to talk about women a little bit in today's lecture. And I want to give you some images that I think will be helpful and will kind of resonate with the images that you see in the films. And I hope that you'll enjoy watching the films. They're both, I think, particularly visually beautiful and really rich in terms of how the directors and the production design teams have thought about the ways in which clothing manifests itself in their stories. And of course, Tom Ford, who directed A Single Man, being a fashion designer, though he did not design the costumes for the film, pays particular attention, I think, to the role that they play in his story. So some questions I want y'all to kind of keep in your minds this week, both in the material I'm going to share with you now, as well as in watching the films, are thinking about how homophobic laws use dress as a means of policing gender and sexuality. And think about what results that has in terms of what people wear within queer communities. I also want to explain to y'all what we mean when we use the term coded, if you don't know. And I'm going to share some examples in relationship to coding of queer characters in film, as well as thinking about, you know, garments and styles that are coded as queer. Hopefully I'll give you some ideas to think about what the significance of clothing was to queer communities pre Stonewall, so the Stonewall riots in 1969, which are often marked as a key turning point in the queer civil rights movement. Although important to note, and I'll give you some material related to this, they certainly were not by any means the beginning of the queer civil rights movement in the United States. There were many predecessors to the Stonewall Uprising. And of course, what's the significance of clothing to these communities post-Stonewall? And also think about how fashion, shaped by styles used in queer communities, impacts communities outside of the queer community, and sort of thinking about the way that style helps to form a sense of community. So I'm going to show you a couple of clips from this really terrific documentary that I'd encourage you to take a look at on your own if you have any interest. It's called The Celluloid Closet. It's a bit old at this point, from 1995, but I think just as relevant as when it first came out. And it's based on a 1981 book by the same title. And this documentary looks at the history of representation of queer characters on film. And what I think will be instructive for you in the first clip that I'm showing you is the ways in which the kind of paradigmatic and stereotypical image of the effeminate gay man is within the realm of cinema from the very beginning, from the period of silent films. And you'll see, I think, how much has unfortunately remained the same in terms of stereotypical representations of gay men. But also notice in terms of fashion that articles of clothing that were deemed feminine are used as markers in filmic representations of these men. And we also have evidence that that was the case in some cases for men who were willing to be more open about their sexuality early on in the early part of the 20th century. certainly not all gay men, but for a certain subset who were willing to be out and more visibly gay, certain kinds of signifiers associated with feminine dress were a way of doing that. There were also much more illegible, at least to straight eyes, signifiers in terms of sharing one's own identity for gay men. So suede shoes, for instance, red neckties, there were certain subtle signifiers that would only be understood by people in the know. And that kind of leads into the second set of, or the second clip that I'm going to show you from this film, which looks at the ways in which queer audiences viewed Hollywood films in, you know, really in for much of the 20th century, when there were no real clear depictions of gay and lesbian characters and queer characters in those films. Queer audiences looked for those characters and found them in some really interesting places. So you'll see some of the ways that the people being interviewed in the Celluloid Closet talk about seeing those characters and seeing those kinds of representations in ways that were particularly exciting to them. This idea of being seen and being recognized on film, and also this skill of reading for those images, finding those images.
An extraordinary moment where Chaplin kisses someone who looks like a man. He knows that it's a woman. And someone else comes along and sees it and immediately starts swishing around in the most kind of overt, effeminate way. Fascinating that those stereotypes were so completely in place that a, you know, mainstream popular film could assume that the audience would know what this swishy mime was all about.
Mr. Ernest.
Ernest.
Dear Ernest.
Dear Lady Grayston.
Ernest, I'm so happy you were able to come.
You must excuse my coming in my tarn clothes, but your chauffeur said there wasn't a moment to lose, so I came just as I am.
Enter the Sissy, Hollywood's first gay stock character. The Sissy made everyone feel more manly or more womanly by occupying the space in between. He didn't seem to have a sexuality, so Hollywood allowed him to thrive.
There were sissies. They were never addressed as homosexuals. It was a convention that was totally accepted.
They were perceived as homosexuals just subliminally. This is a subject that was not discussed privately, certainly not publicly.
It wasn't discussed, but you knew. They were all very prissy. You know, these little skinny white men with little mustaches who would go like this.
Girls, be careful of my hats.
Well, we gotta get down on the stage.
I don't care. I won't allow you to ruin them.
I told you, they were too high and too wide.
Well, big woman, I designed the costumes for the show, not the doors for the theater.
I know that. If you had, they'd have been done in lavender.
This is Ripped. Who were you with last night?
Strangler Lewis.
Oh, catch as catch can, hmm? I'm telling you, if we could get the runs with this show that these dames get in their stockings, I'd be able to make the second payment on my kimono.
Here, Clarence, put that in the trunk. And don't wear it.
Selfish.
They were a cliche. And I don't care whether they were a gay cliche or what. I thought they were disgusting, unfunny, had no business being in it. And I never understood why people laughed. It's the same thing when they had the step and fetch. It's for the blacks.
I like the sissy. Is it used in negative ways? Yeah, but my view has always been visibility at any cost. I'd rather have negative than nothing. That's just my particular view, and also because I am a sissy.
And go dashing up and down the hall.
In one movie, you could even find sissies table hopping in Hollywood's first peek at a gay bar.
If a sailor in pajamas I should see, I know he'd scare the life out of me. And on a great big battleship you'd like to be, working as chambermaids as snug.
Well, sissy characters in movies were always a joke. There's no sin like being a woman. When a man dresses as a woman, the audience laughs. When a woman dresses as a man, nobody laughs. They just thought she looked wonderful.
I saw Marlene Dietrich in Morocco when I was a teenager. I just was flipping the channels and saw her and decided to settle in for an old movie. And there's this scene where she comes into a nightclub and she's just stunning in this tuxedo.
May I have this?
Of course.
And the camera lingers. I mean, it wasn't like I was catching this out of the side of the screen. It's right in the center. She has a romance with Gary Cooper in this movie, but that romance just went right out the window for me. I was just like, who was that woman? What had happened? I start writing a whole other script for what was really going on.
So the thing worked for everybody of every sex. And what's amazing, I don't think they've done anything as delicious sexually as that since. They didn't pretend it was anything but what it was. She was doing it to turn on both the woman and the man, which appealed to everybody, as it should. It was so free.
Ebba, come in.
Now don't dally, Your Majesty. You have a busy day.
Morning, Ebba. What are you doing up so early?
I couldn't sleep.
The movie Queen Christina was based on the life of a real Swedish monarch and lesbian. Hollywood changed the story, but traces of the truth seem to linger.
There are rumors that Your Majesty is planning a foreign marriage.
They're baseless.
But, Your Majesty, you cannot tie an old maid.
I have no intention to, Chancellor. I shall die a bachelor.
We hope that it will not be necessary to close all the motion picture houses because of some of the ones that are not desirable, but that we will have cleaner and better motion.
I may be wrong, but in Young Man with a Horn, we have one of my favorite lesbian glamour symbols.
She was interesting, isn't she? So simple and uncomplicated. Must be wonderful to wake up in the morning and know just which door you're going to walk through. She's so terribly normal.
She's a good singer, too.
I like Lauren Bacall because she gets up in the morning and she has no idea what's going to happen to her next.
I'm dying to see the rest of your sketches.
We'll have dinner out and then go back to my place.
How nice of you to come to the party, Richard. This is my husband, Miss Carson. I told you about her, the girl who paints so well.
How do you do?
How do you do? See you at 9 then, Amy.
Fine.
It's been a wonderful party.
Those movies were a warning to ladies to just watch it and get back to the kitchen, where God meant them to be.
What a swell combination we were. You said you wanted experiences, Amy. Well, here's one for you. I'm leaving you.
I'd like to kill you.
You almost did. You're a sick girl, Amy. You better see a doctor.
So that example of Marlene Dietrich in the film Morocco. And I've watched the film Morocco. And let me tell you, there is nothing exciting about the film Morocco except for that scene, which is one of the most exciting things I've seen on film in the 1930s. The rest of the film, kind of a dud. But it's a pretty electrifying scene. And as the documentary suggests, it was one of the sort of rare instances where you have a really clear image of lesbianism or bisexuality, however you want to identify Diedrich's character in that film, on screen in this ever-present way. Diedrich, in her personal life, also wore trousers and tuxedos. She showed up to a movie premiere in 1932 in a tuxedo, and you can see Gary Cooper and Maurice Chevalier on the other side looking rather uncomfortable that she hasn't shown up to this premiere in a gown. So she certainly pushed the envelope, and this in many ways made her a queer icon in the 1930s and far beyond. Another example of a Hollywood icon for queer communities is Katharine Hepburn. And this, you know, might not be something you're aware of, particularly for lesbian women, because a number of her early roles, she either cross-dressed, as she does in Sylvia Scarlett, in the plot of that film, she pretends to be a boy. And in Christopher Strong, she plays an aviatrix. And there's definitely a kind of way in which you can read that film as having a kind of lesbian subplot in it. So both two terrific films. If you want to immerse yourself in the 1930s, I highly recommend both of them. But even in her later, I'd argue somewhat more conventional films, although many of Katharine Hepburn's films weren't terribly conventional, she appears in trousers and also in more kind of masculine roles. And so she was a real icon for the lesbian community. I've read that you would often see photographs of her in lesbian bars in this period and long after. So in terms of what real women who were lesbians might be wearing or who were queer, I wanted to give you one example. You know, these are histories that are largely hidden and are being reconstructed and put back together by scholars, even now, in really important ways. And one of the histories that I ran across as I was doing some research for a project looking at women wearing pants is the story of Evelyn Jackie Bross, who you see here on the left-hand side of that photograph on the left, and then in the photograph in the center. In 1943, she was arrested on her way home from work. She was just 19 years old, and that's the photograph you see of her arrest. She was the eldest of 13 children in a family, a Cherokee family, Native American family. Her father had moved the family to Chicago from Utah during the war to take advantage of the wartime jobs that were available there, factory jobs and so forth. And like her father, Jackie Bross worked in a defense plant and was employed as a machinist. So a highly skilled worker. She worked at the Chicago Die Casting Company on West Monroe Street. And she was walking home on West Jackson Street when the police stopped her. According to the Chicago Tribune, Bross was, quote, dressed in blue flannel trousers, a plaid sport shirt, a plaid Mackinaw jacket, and Oxfords. Topping it off, she had a, quote, mannish haircut. And you can see the clothes that she was taken into the police station in these photographs. As early as 1851, Chicago had a law that outlawed cross-dressing in public places. It was considered under the law kind of indecent exposure. This was very typical of laws in American cities. Many cities enacted these kinds of rules. If you look at the dates when they came into, and when these laws came into being, in many places, it's the 1850s. It's the moment of bloomerism. So I suspect if we looked a little bit deeper, we would probably find a connection to that kind of this moment of anxiety in the 1850s of women taking on trousers, and so these laws coming into being. In any case, those laws became a vehicle for policing queer communities. And I think that's in part what was happening with the arrest of Bross in Chicago. It comes at, though, an interesting moment because it's coming in World War II. And Bross is doing the thing that American women are being asked to do, which is to support the war effort. So unlike the Zoot Suiters, who we talked about a couple of weeks ago, who are perceived as working against the rationing laws and not supporting the war effort, Bross is supporting the war effort. And in fact, her clothing is a part of doing that because she can't work as a machinist in a dress. So she informs the judge when she goes before him in her case that she chose to wear men's clothing for her work. She says, quote, that she is more comfortable, that they are more comfortable than women's clothes and handy for work. But she went on and she declared, I wish I was a boy. I never did anything wrong. I just like to wear men's clothes, but everyone knows I'm a woman. What was really interesting about this case is that it really struck a nerve because she was doing this essential war work, and many people somewhat unexpectedly spoke out on her behalf, including some of the leading Chicago women's clubs that supported her on feminist grounds, saying women's suffrage and slacks ought to go hand in hand. A regional federal officer for war industry employment named Harry Gilbert was enraged at her arrest and said, if a girl cut her hair short, she should be awarded a medal instead of a court summons. Safety directors in factories everywhere have tried to encourage women to cut their hair short. So these folks actually saw Bross as a kind of hero who had adapted her way of dressing to the needs of wartime. Kind of, you know, disregarding the fact that these were also personal choices that might have reflected her own identity and her own tastes. There was eventually an action on behalf of the Board of Aldermen in the city, and there was an amendment to the law that prohibited cross-dressing only when there was an intent to conceal his or her sex. So in other words, the law was changed to say that cross-dressing was only illegal if you were trying to pass yourself off as the opposite sex or the opposite gender in our parlance now. So as of 1943, the law had changed as a result of this. But sadly, after this drama of, you know, all these women's groups kind of coming to Bross's aid, the judge still would not relent. And you can see here, I think, the ways in which Bross is, at least, you know, we don't know how Bross would have identified in terms of gender and sexuality in a super clear way. Although we do know that she said she wished she had been born a boy, which perhaps tells us something. But certainly the judge was uncomfortable with Bross's gender presentation, if nothing else. And when Bross came back to court, there was another woman in court that day named Theodora Fitzpatrick, and she was wearing trousers as well. And the judge, in this peculiar way, sort of made an example of her. She was described in the newspapers as looking like a Hollywood star and having lots of blonde hair with a ribbon and wearing this neat tailored slack suits. That's how the newspapers described it. She'd been picked up, P.S., on suspicion of prostitution, but she was actually returning from a visit to New York to see her husband, who was a sailor. The judge made Bross and this other woman, Fitzpatrick, stand side by side. Bross was wearing that day, quote, rough trousers, a sweater, a lumberjack shirt, and a muffler, end quote. And the judge decided to make a statement about this and said, Miss Fitzpatrick has the right to wear slacks. Miss Fitzpatrick shows that there should be no objection to women wearing slacks if the wearer does not intend to impersonate a male. There's a difference. And so he was indicating that Bross was trying to pass as male. So he couldn't send her to jail because of the public outcry. But perhaps worse, he ended up putting her under psychiatric supervision for 6 months. Bross refused to relent in terms of her case and said, I'll put on a skirt if I have to, but I won't let my hair grow. If I dress like a girl, I'll look like a boy anyway, and I'll be picked up more often. The police will say I'm impersonating a girl. And it's important to note that the law in Chicago does not get eliminated until 1978. And these were the same kinds of laws that were enforced in New York and many other municipalities and cities in the U.S. That allowed for the systematic harassing of the queer community in arrests at gay and lesbian bars and you know, queer night spots and things like that that lead up to the Stonewall Uprising. So I think it's an incredible story of an incredible person, Jackie Ross, who I wish history could teach us a little bit more about. But I love that we have these pictures of Ross. And I'm just showing you a couple other images that I found of kind of looks to me like some women in Chicago in sort of zoot suits. So anyway, I think a lot more history here to uncover. And I should say some of these come from the Chicago History Museum, an exhibition that they did about the queer communities of Chicago. So they've been working on this research. So now I want to show you a bit of a long excerpt from the film Before Stonewall. And I want to show it to you because I think you should get to hear from the voices of people who lived this history rather than just my voice. So this is a fantastic film. Again, it's a little bit older, from 1984. But the wonderful thing about it is that we can hear the voices of people who were at the forefront of the fight for gay and lesbian civil rights and queer civil rights, as well as the establishment and the maintaining of this queer community. So I'm going to show you a clip that will kind of take us from Bross's moment of World War II, and in some ways, some of the possibilities, as I think Bross's story shows us, that get opened up for the queer community in terms of expressing their identity in that moment, in some ways that might be a little bit unexpected. And that will then sort of take us into the Cold War period of the 1950s and give you a sense of the ways in which there was a kind of clampdown and a quashing of these relative freedoms that existed, very relative, let me emphasize that, and you'll see that in the clip, in the 1940s, but also some of the ways that might be unexpected if you have like a kind of particular image of the 1950s, that queer communities were actually coming together in more visible ways in that historical moment. And I think sometimes it's easy to think of the 1950s as this really like staid and conservative moment compared to like the swinging 60s and the sexual revolution. But in fact, we could see the sexual revolution and this kind of liberalizing of ideas around sexuality is really starting, and there are kind of foundations happening in the 50s. And I think that this clip will show you that. So it's worth knowing that Playboy magazine, for instance, was founded in 1953. So images of sexuality were becoming more present, for better or worse, depending on your point of view, in the public sphere. The birth control pill was approved by the FDA in 1957. At that point, only for severe menstrual disorders, but very quickly it will be used as contraception by women. And in terms of gay and lesbian civil rights, the Mattachine Society was founded in 1950, and you'll hear from Harry Hay. He's going to be the one in the turquoise necklace who was the founder of that. We'll talk about his then partner, Rudy Geinrich, in our last class, who was a fashion designer, who was one of the financiers of that organization, but who chose to remain a kind of silent partner because he was worried that it would affect his business. Even though everyone who knew him knew that he was a gay man, he didn't want the kind of general public to know. So I think that gives you a sense. And this is in the 1960s when he's a really popular fashion designer. In any case, that society was founded by Hay and others in 1950, and you'll hear a bit from him. The Daughters of Blightus, a lesbian organization, was founded in 1954. As you'll read in Paula Rabinowitz's essay about pulp paperbacks, especially ones about lesbians, between 1950 and 1965, over 500 of those titles were published. And you'll also hear a little bit about the Kinsey Report in this clip. I think that'll give you a sense of some of the conversations that were happening in the 1950s.